Penguin Random House Audio presents The Road from Belhaven, a novel by Margot Livesey, read for you by Ell Potter. For Kirsty Shorter, 1990 to 2023. By night and day we'll sport and we'll play, and delight as the dawn dances over the bay. Sleep blows the breath of the morning away, and we follow the heron home. Follow the Heron Home by Kareen Polwart. 1. The summer she was 10, she learned not to speak of it. She told the hens, she told the cows, she told the pond at the bottom of the field and the ducks who swam there, and her pet jackdaw, Alice. But she did not tell her grandparents, Rab and Flora, or Hugh, the farm boy, or Nellie, who had helped in the house when she, Lizzie, was learning to walk, and whom they still saw every week at the kirk. The first picture came on a dreich November day. Her grandmother was in the dairy, skimming milk, her grandfather in the fields, digging potatoes. She was beneath the kitchen table, making scones for her doll. She must have been 3 or 4, when the flagstone floor and her bowl and spoon disappeared. Instead, she was watching her grandfather, his shirt sleeves rolled up, scything hay in the meadow by the river. He was working his way along the bank, cutting wide swathes. One moment the hay was upright, the next fallen. At the end of the row, he stopped to sharpen the scythe. She could see his shirt clinging to his back as he ran the whetstone back and forth. He was starting on the next row when the blade bit his calf. She was still exclaiming, "No!" scrambling from beneath the table when the kitchen door opened and her grandfather stepped into the room carrying a basket of potatoes. As he washed them at the sink, she patted his legs, searching for the cut beneath the rough fabric of his trousers. "What is it, Lizzie?" he said. "Do I have mud on me?" She told him what she'd seen. "I'd have to be gay clumsy," he said, "to cut myself digging tatties." She was still wondering why she had seen a scythe, not a fork, why the sun had been shining though the sky was grey, when her grandmother returned, and together they went to feed the hens. By the following July, when Neil, their neighbour, carried her grandfather home in a wheelbarrow, she had forgotten the scene beneath the table. Only as Dr. Murray made dark, untidy stitches in Rab's leg did she recall her glimpse of the meadow months before. She thought of them as pictures, because she could see everything so clearly, as if she were standing nearby, although she never saw herself. Sometimes she saw ordinary things, her grandmother choosing which hen to kill, a cow stuck in the mud by the river. She saw a picture of Nellie in a white dress at the front of the church, and 3 months later Nellie announced she was marrying Angus. "You could have knocked me down with a feather," her grandmother said, reporting the news at supper. Lizzie started to say she had known for weeks, but her grandfather was already talking about the sheep shearing. All this happened at Belhaven Farm, which was in that part of Scotland called the Kingdom of Fife, surrounded on 3 sides by water, the Firth of Forth to the south, the North Sea to the east, the Tay Estuary to the north. Fife was known for its collieries, its fishing, and its university in St Andrews, but the farm was inland, far from the coal mines. The year of Lizzie's birth, the explorer David Livingstone died in Africa, the RMS Atlantic sank off Nova Scotia, and the Scottish Rugby Union was founded. On the farm, the most notable events, besides her arrival, were the mild weather and the early harvest. Her great-great-grandfather had bought the farm in 1807 with money he made in linen. The gently rolling land was 2 miles from the village of Langmuir, 6 miles from the market town of Cooper. He had put a new roof on the white Harald farmhouse and planted the beech trees that cast too much shade in the garden. Next to the house was an apple orchard, and beyond that a field where Acorn, the mare, and Ivanhoe and Rob Roy, the cart horses, grazed. The cows mostly stayed in a large field beside the farmyard. In the south corner of the field, near the gate, was the duck pond. In the north corner was a small circle of standing stones, 2 fallen. Down by the river Elder was the meadow where her grandfather had cut himself. Other fields, farther away, were used for turnips, potatoes, corn, barley, oats, and hay. The north pasture and the moorland belonged to the sheep. It was her great-grandfather who had planted the rowan tree beside the door of the farmhouse to keep witches away, and built the lean-to which sheltered the carts, the plough, and the harrow. The other buildings, the barn, the byre, the granary, the dairy, the henhouse, the stable, and the hayloft, were part of the original farm. Between the house and the farmyard, a track led south to the river, and north, past the Lochan, to the village of Langmuir. As a child, Lizzie knew every stone and puddle and nettle. She spent her days with her grandmother, Flora, who was tall and blue-eyed, and sometimes carried Lizzie on her shoulders when she went to fetch the cows. Lizzie would pat her golden knot of hair, inhale her comforting fragrance of green soap and tea. When she drew a cow in the back of the Voyage of the Beagle, Flora spanked her but kept the drawing. Next time her grandfather went to market in Cooper, he brought back a book full of blank paper and 2 pencils. "Now mind," he told her, "leave my books alone." Where were her parents? On the wall of her bedroom. Her mother had made the drawing the day they got married. Helen, wearing a dress, the folds nicely shaded, was sitting in a chair. Teddy, in his Sunday suit, stood behind her, his left hand resting on her shoulder. Lizzie seldom glanced at them, but every morning she looked at the little white house with 2 red doors which had belonged to Helen and which stood on her chest of drawers. In fine weather, the woman came out of her door. In bad weather, the man emerged. Sometimes each hovered on the threshold, but they could never come out at the same time. Besides the weather house and the drawing, Lizzie had inherited her mother's border terrier, William, whom they buried in the apple orchard soon after her grandfather cut himself, and a handful of stories. Helen could undo any knot. She could imitate a thrush so that birds sang back. She had rescued a calf from drowning in the river. She was partial to gooseberry jam. About her father, she knew even less. Teddy had been a fisherman. His boat was named St. Fillan, after the saint who had lived in a cave on the Fife coast and wrote by the light of his glowing left arm. But neither God nor St. Fillan had saved Teddy's boat when the fog rolled in one October day. 7 months later, Lizzie was born. 12 months later, Helen died. "Not because of you," Flora had said. "Pneumonia. Your father drowned in one way, your mother in another." She had the ducks and the hens for company, the orphaned lambs and calves, but whenever she and Flora went to Langmuir, she gazed longingly at the girls in the school playground. At last, the August she was 5, she set off to join them, wearing a clean pinafore, carrying a slice of bread and a piece of cheese for her lunch. She walked the 1st mile on her own, past their fields and the track that led to the Lochan and Neil's fields. Then she knocked on Dr. Murray's door and walked the rest of the way with Morag, the oldest of his 3 girls. On that first day, Morag hung back, afraid of the boys jostling in the playground. But Lizzie ran into the schoolroom eager to begin. The teacher, Miss Renfrew, put her in a desk next to Sarah, who lived in a house near the blacksmith's. Her milky skin was dotted with...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.